Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Welcome to St. Paul's on this, the first Sunday in which our curate, Father David Povall, acts as deacon at the Eucharist, as his ordination as deacon took place yesterday in Southern Cathedral at 5 p.m. David's already established himself as a figure amongst us, a hard-working and creative person. I've even suggested he might clean the vicarage windows, and he didn't say no. But it's great that now, after so much prayer and preparation, David has been ordained. And we welcome you, Father David, amongst us with great joy and thanksgiving. At the beginning of this Eucharist, asked by the bishop, the incumbent of new curates who have been recently ordained, asked those curates to make a declaration with lay witnesses. So I asked our church warden, Nick Curtis, to come up and stand just below the sanctuary, together with our PCC secretary, Cynthia Woodhouse, to be the designated witnesses. The Church of England is part of one holy, Catholic and apostolic Church, worshipping the one true God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It professes the faith uniquely revealed in the Holy Scriptures and set forth in the Catholic creeds, which faith the Church is called upon to proclaim afresh in each generation. Led by the Holy Spirit, it has borne witness to Christian truth in its historic formularies, the 39 Articles of Religion, the Book of Common Prayer, and the ordering of bishops, priests, and deacons. Father David, in the declaration you are about to make, will you affirm your loyalty to this inheritance of faith as your inspiration and guidance under God in bringing the grace and truth of Christ to this generation and making him known to those in your care?
I, David Justin Pope, do so affirm and accordingly declare my belief in the faith, which is revealed in the Holy Scriptures and set forth in the Catholic creeds, and to which the historic formularies of the Church of England bear witness, and in public prayer and in administration of the sacraments, I will use only the forms of service which are authorised or allowed I can.
David now hands this declaration to Nick, and afterwards Nick and Cynthia will sign it, and it will be delivered back to our diocese. Let's welcome David now as deacon amongst us.
Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. Second is love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven and bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love, and peace with all."
Thank you.
Almighty God,
our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We stand and say together, Gloria in excelsis. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Let us pray. God, who in generous mercy sent the Holy Spirit upon your church in the burning fire of your love, grant that your people may be fervent in the fellowship of the gospel, but always abiding in you, they may be found steadfast in faith and active in service, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
When God saw what the people of Nineveh did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had set and bring upon them, and he did not do it. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, O Lord, is not this what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish. For I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, and ready to relent from punishing. And now, O Lord, would you please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. And the Lord said, is it right for you to be angry? Then Jonah went out of the city, and sat down east of the city, and made a booth for himself there. He sat under it in the shade, waiting to see what would happen in the city. The Lord God appointed a bush, and made it come up over Jonah to give shade over his head, to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was very happy about the bush. But when dawn came up the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the bush so that it withered. When the sun rose, God prepared a sultry east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah so that he was faint, and asked that he might die. He said, it is better for me to die than to live. But God said to Jonah, is it right for you to be angry about the bush? And he said, yes, angry enough to die. Then the Lord said, you are concerned about the bush for which you did not labor and which you did not grow. It came into being in a night and perished in a night. And and should I not be concerned about Nineveh, that great city, in which there are more than 120,000 people who do not know their right hand from their left, and also many animals? This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
said to his disciples, "The kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire labourers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the labourers for the usual daily charge, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. And he said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard, I will pay you whatever is right.' So they went. When he went out again about noon, and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them, 'Why are you standing here idle all day?' They said to him, 'Because no one has hired us.' He said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard.' When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, 'Call the labourers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first.' When they hired about 5 o'clock again, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, 'These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us, who have borne the burden of the day in the scorching heat.' But he replied to them, 'Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?' So the last will be first, and the first will be last." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
This parable, we are presented with a story of a series of tempting to persist in selfishness, greed and pride, saying to ourselves, it's all right, I'll put things straight before I die. And the psalmist shows us our foolishness. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, Lord, you know it completely. There's no way to cheat God. He knows exactly the parts in your head. Just think for a moment of what is implied by the ideas of burning and cheating, and you'll start to see the vital truth that is unsaid in this parable when it's taken on its own. When we consider God, we should be thinking not of transactions, but of relationship. The psalmist again. If I were hungry, I would not tell you, for the world and all that is in it is mine. Do I eat the flesh of bulls or drink the blood of goats? Offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving and pay your vows the most high. Doing our duty, attending Mass, fasting, giving alms, is so much empty posture if it is not rooted in gratitude and love. We do things for people we love because we love them, not because of what we hope to get out of it. And so doing things for them, however onerous they may be, is natural and joyful. The world tells us that virtuous, righteous living is a sacrifice. It's hard, it means giving up pleasures and suppressing our appetites in unnatural ways. And in our fallen state, mired as we are in sin, that is how we feel. But it is also the way in which we can thank God and tell Him that we love Him, and we can come close to Him. What do we get out of it? Nothing. You may have heard of the prosperity gospel. A teaching in some nominally Christian sects that if your faith is strong enough, you'll be rich. It is a falsehood. It is the work of the devil. Living in a way that expresses our love for God will not make us rich. It won't save us from illness or suffering. How often have we commented that it isn't fair that so and so, kind and prayerful person, has suffered some terrible loss or illness. Being close to God won't even give us a warm and fuzzy feeling of well-being. A few years ago, I reached a point where it seemed that everywhere I looked, there was pain, loss, suffering. Horrible cases of work. Friends and marriages were breaking down, death and disaster in the news. And praying for those in distress can itself be painful. I felt warm. And a wise and thoughtful friend who was a priest told me that when we feel the pain of others' suffering, then we are close to the heart of Jesus. Ever since then, I've come to that thought like a lifeline. Because while God will not probably make us feel warm and fuzzy and happy and wealthy, He will, in my experience, what I've observed, give us enough to persevere. Our faith is not about doing X to get Y. Our Lord was crucified. And we are called not to do the necessary to earn rewards and salvation, but to take up our cross and follow. Trying to do deals with God is the most supreme paradise. essential truth that he created us all and that nothing exists without him. And as our very being is contingent on him, our love for him must be an act of self-abnegation, in which we surrender our will, our ideas of what we want and need, to his will. So if we understand this parable to be about humanity's relationship with God, then it is the workers who worked all day long in the hot sun who have had the privilege of serving most faithfully and being closest to God. As so often St. John of the Cross says it perfectly. In order to arrive at having pleasure in everything, desire to have pleasure in nothing. In order to arrive at possessing everything, desire to possess nothing. In order to arrive at being everything, desire to be nothing. Amen. Sylvia Phillips, Claire Palmer, Samantha, Josh Collins, Sarah Booth, Tessa Henderson, Val Spicer, and Steve Kochler. Give them courage and hope of their trials, and bring them to the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Hear us as we remember those who have died in the faith of Christ, remembering particularly those whose years lie before this week, among them Kaya and Lawrence. According to your promises, grant us with them a share in your eternal kingdom. Rest eternal grant unto their own Lord, and let light perpetual shine on them. Rejoicing in the fellowship of Mary, of St. Paul, and all your saints, we commend ourselves to the whole creation, to your unfailing love. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Merciful Father, accept these prayers
and for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Would you stand? Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer each other, without touching, a sign of peace.
Let us pray. Yours, Lord, is the power, splendor, and the majesty. Everything on heaven and on earth is yours. All things come from you, and of your own do we give you. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Father, we give you thanks and praise to your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh. As your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin, he lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us, and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest.
Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body which is given to you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me.
Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
And so far, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of St. Mary the Virgin, St. Paul, and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom, and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
Amen.
Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his Son.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
Thank you. Keep, O Lord, your church with your perpetual mercy, and because without you our human frailty cannot but fall, keep us ever by your help from all things hurtful, and lead us to all things profitable to our salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Would you sit down for a moment? Have we got a special presentation, Rob?
Here is the Paul set in this beautiful green space. We have much
focus on. Then we'll be inaugurating a week to mark Creation Tide, and we are hoping to have two moments during the week, one on Wednesday at 7 p.m. where we usually provide recorded evening prayers as a time to hear talk about the plants and the trees that grow around this church, which is going to be offered by a member of the Eden Garden community. And then on the Saturday afternoon, when we often have a Zoom meeting, I'm hoping that I'll be able to take up one of the kind offers that's been made by a number of people. I still have to talk to the people who've made the offers to see what we could offer to do something creatively together again on Zoom. But we'll let you know about this from our Thursday newsletter. We'll close the Creation Tide week with a harvest festival here in church on the feast of St. Francis of Assisi, October 4th. I was wondering whether I might invite you to bring your pets to next week's service outside, but I don't think I can do that, as we might have to be inside. So, well, you know, we've got a church cat who walks in from time to time, and there's certainly been dogs in church in my time. So if you fancy bringing a tortoise or an aquarium with you, that's up to you. Would you stand to prepare yourselves to receive God's blessing? The peace of God, which